In Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 30, the Lord called his people to stand in the gap for the well-being of God's people.
Watching the maiden edition of What Is This? Weapons. He carries also on his head the chairman Ghana Pentecostal Charismatic Council, and he is the president Assemblies of God Church, and he is my guest as we center on What Is This for small arms and light weapons in our dear country. The National Commission on Small Arms and Light Weapons is an agency established by an Act of Parliament, Act 736 of 2007. It exists, among other things, to prevent, combat, and eradicate the illicit trade in small arms and light weapons, educate and sensitize the public, and provide information on the dangers of small arms and light weapons in order to discourage their production. Reverend Professor Frimpo Manso, you are welcome.
Thank you. My namesake.
Yes.
And my brother.
I know. But let me ask you, what wakes you up in the night as far as this dear country is concerned?
The gun proliferation and the situation of arms spread, illegal spread of arms, and of course the killings that we hear, you know, day in and day out, it really wakes me up. Every night, it makes me worry. It gives me a great concern about the safety and the security of our dear nation.
And at the moment, young people go into entertainment to sing and dance, and they pull guns. Funeral grounds, there people are pulling guns. Police officers are being attacked with guns. Now, what you chair the National Commission on Small Arms and Light Weapons, what is the mandate of this commission?
Before I come in, let me take this opportunity to express my condolences to the five policemen and women who were killed when they were offering services to our dear nation, and a lot of others who have been murdered because of the proliferation of arms in this country. Yes, Small Arms Commission, as you have said, was set up by an Act of Parliament, Act 736, in 2007, to regulate the arms situation in the country. They are first supposed to educate the public about the use of arms. They are also supposed to advise the minister, give an advocacy role. They are also supposed to represent this country at the United Nations, OAU, ECOWAS, and other foreign bodies in terms of armed trade and armed treaty in this nation. Basically, anything that has to do with small arms has been ceded by the government to be carried on by this commission. It's a strong and powerful commission, if well supported and well, you know, managed, could be a tool to promote peace and security in our nation.
Now, what would you consider to be the achievement of this commission over the years?
Over the years, both in Ghana and outside Ghana, Small Arms Commission have championing the regulation of arms, especially small arms. In the UN, AU, and ECOWAS, when we mention Small Arms Commission in Ghana, we are seen to be among the top flight organizations. Well, in terms of education, we do periodic educations. We sometimes collect illegal weapons and burn them in public. We even did one last year. We were the people who, you know, organized the baseline report even to know how much arms that have been circulated in the country. We keep educating, especially during electioneering period and other times. We have been engaged in marking and tracing of arms. We have done a lot, but I would say that more is yet to be done.
More is yet to be done. We are getting ready for election 2020. Mm. Now, the various political parties are having their primaries, and even sometimes internal party activities, people are pulling guns. And that suggests to us, as we move into the future, 2020, how bad is the small arms situation at the moment?
Well, you know what happened at Ayo West Wagon recently. You know what happened at NDC head office. You know the killing that has been going around. To me, it is daring. On record, when we did a baseline report in 2016, we found out that there could be about 2.1 million guns in the hands of people, but only few are registered. But even those that are registered, most of them, when they license it, and they license it one time, they don't. We had a record that 1.6 million guns have been registered. That was last year. Only 40,000 are renewed annually. So for the rest of 1.56 million guns, we do not know where they are. Another thing that makes it dire is this. In Ghana, there's no law to limit the number of guns somebody can own. So he can build an arsenal, one man. In South Africa, you're supposed to have maximum of 5. In Ghana, Reverend Dr. Oponi Frimpong can buy 1 million guns and keep it. So individuals can keep arsenals. Thinking about the illegally manufactured weapons at different places, thinking about the porous borders where people can bring guns. Some chiefs have got their own armories, seeing religious conflicts, terrorist things. So long as the gun situation is concerned, even though the law has put together intelligent and competent people from the army, the police, the interior, attorney general department, customs, and all, to be, you know, to handle this situation, they are just advices, and the minister doesn't have to consult them by the meaning of the word advice. And I tell you, guns come into this country, we know they are distributed. We, as I sit here, I don't know even those who are the importers, well, they don't have to tell us. Recently, there was gun situation in Tema that people have brought in illegal weapons. When we made investigation, it was a going minister, even a deputy minister, who signed this, who gave the license for this amount of guns to come when they have already been voted out about 2 days to leave office. So, look at the irony, my namesake, Dr. Oponi Frimpong. We can go to the military armory to check their small arms. We can go to the police armory because we know them, we know where they are. But for the invisible arm importers, we do not even know them. We don't know the quantity of arms they bring in, no inventory, no database. We do not know where they sell them and who buy them. And then they keep importing. So the situation is very, very, very serious.
Now, Dr. Frimpong Mansu, you are telling me that the commission can go to the security agencies
yes.
to find out
yes.
the amount of
weapons.
And they are doing wonderful. I mean, the police and the military, they are law-abiding and they are doing wonderful. I must commend them in terms of armed regulations.
But your commission cannot go to Alavanyo, cannot go to Kumasi magazine to find out who is producing small arms and how many they have done within a month.
Not even the Kumasi one, that is a small part of it. Even the importers, I'm saying that, not that we cannot go, we don't even know them. To me, as I'm a chairman here, my commission sees the arm importers as invisible human beings who are importing arms into this country. Of course, to the Ministry of Interior, they are not invisible because they give them the license. To the police, they are not invisible because I think they know how it is gone. They register them. But that is the situation. Then coming to the manufacturers at magazine and the rest, well, we don't have mechanism. Even though the Kumasi people have organized themselves to make as a body to regulate themselves, they are looking even for a vehicle so that we will be able to monitor them and control them and direct them. I am still praying that probably one day the vehicle will drop from heaven, because I've tried every means to get a vehicle for the Blasphemous Association. In fact, some of them say that they have a great pain when people say that it is the Blasphemous who are producing these guns, where we are destroying their businesses, we are giving them a bad name, so they organize themselves to do peer checks and self-regulate to make sure that that bad name that they have acquired should be taken away from them. But no help from anywhere is even directing to them so that that can be done. And that is very, very unfortunate.
Yeah, but tell me, the scenario you are describing, is it just the past 2 years? How old has it been? How long have we lived with this?
As old as the time of Nkrumah. We had Nkrumah, a law in 1962. A champion came in and made another one in 1972. So basically, it is 1972 law, which is so archaic and outmoded, that is governing. The Small Arms Commission has been set, but it hasn't got a teeth to bite. Its powers are limited. We have become like an appendix. So, I mean, if you talk about commission, lands commission, minerals commission, electoral commission, and all the commissions, you read our act. The powers of our commission is really not a commission. I don't know why we even took that name. Because when I was appointed chairman of the Small Arms Commission, I thought I've got great military generals, army officers, policemen. We are a body, a force to make sure that we control the armed situation. Then you read the law, you educate, you do this. But then you are an advisory body. And so the person whom you are supposed to advise, he is not bound to ask any advice from you. And lo and behold, we are very much neglected. Since I went to that office, I'm yet to see a point in time that we have been asked to give a serious advice on any situation. Probably the executive secretary and his team might have been advising and working. But so long as my office is concerned, of course, I've got our management committee and the rest. I want to assume that they are offering that kind of advice, but I don't really think we are being used. Resource persons like Major General Omania Jikum, Colonel Japon, Police Yohonu, Mami Chiwa, lawyers from Attorney General Department. Now we can't even hold meetings, because we go to meetings, there is nothing for us to do. We got to go there and talk and talk and lament and lament and come back.
But we must still discuss what is next.
Oh, yeah.
We must still discuss beyond the situation you've described. Now, are you by this, what we have just heard, telling my viewers that if I have listened to the interior minister recently, especially when the police officers, you know, and the seriousness and that even the MTTD people must go out. Are you saying that the laws governing the use, acquisition, and the use of small arms must be revisited?
We have made the law reform commission. We have done a lot of things with regard to the law. Its ineffectiveness, we submitted it to the minister. The Attorney General Department is aware, so we are waiting for them to push it through Parliament for it to be done, and then the President gives us an assent. So yes, we have sent everything to the minister. He has it on his desk. If he hasn't received it, I'm asking his secretaries to push it to him. Then too, the Attorney General Department is aware. The Law Reform Committee is aware. National Security has got a copy of our minister. Foreign Ministry have got a copy. We are waiting for them to work together and work fast to submit this thing to Parliament so that it will be reviewed, and the President, who believes in peace and has fought for the... In fact, it was during President Akufo-Addo's time as a foreign minister that this commission was formed. And personally, he supports us, he has told us he will do everything for us to be able to work to promote safety and security in this nation. So I think if the ministry and all those people will push it quicker to them, including the Parliament Select Committee on all these things, things could be better. And we are sitting on time bomb as the elections are approaching, terrorists and all the things that we are seeing. So what next is the law? Unless the law is reformed and changed and giving the Small Arms Commission more mandate, training people. You know, people can go and buy arms without any training. They don't even ask them where they will keep it. You can just transfer your arms to anybody without anything. So the law is there, but so loose and porous, anybody can take advantage of it and create more confusion in this country.
Viewers, I'm in conversation with Reverend Professor Frimpong Mansur. He is the chairman of the National Commission on Small Arms and Light Weapons. And he is saying that the laws governing acquisition and use of small arms and light weapons in this country must be revisited. Asofo, till we get there, what should ordinary Ghanaian be doing?
We should be our brother's keeper. We should protect ourselves. And when we see strange people in our communities holding arms here and there, we must question them. Also, what we will say is that if you don't really need a gun, don't go and buy one. Do you know what is happening? Sometimes people buy guns thinking they are protecting themselves, but they don't know even how to use it. So these armed robbers will go and attack them with toy guns, and the people will rather equip them with AK-47 and pop action guns and the rest. They normally come, if you have a gun, bring it with a toy gun. And out of fear and, you know, sudden, they will just go under their bed and bring these guns to them. So they will normally go to people unarmed and come back fully armed. And sometimes the way people put guns in their houses, you can be angry with your wife or your husband, and you may probably misfire. See the sad story that happened to that Achimota girl some years ago. The father was keeping a gun in the house. A boy, a girlfriend visited a boy. He just brought a gun, didn't know what happened, and killed this beautiful girl. So we should not joke with guns. Read our cases, the true motion. So we should not joke or play with guns. And during festivities like Abuachere, Ade, and those kind of ceremonies, we should not play or toy with guns. Do you know that we don't even have any record, we the Small Arms Commission, about the guns that are being used by the chiefs in their palaces? You go to Winneba, Abuachere, people will take these guns. We don't even know where they are kept and how they are protected. So we must be very, very, very particular. So we must report people to the police, give tip-offs. langers holding guns everywhere. I really, the whole thing is, I can't describe it. I can only feel it. It's so serious, my brother. And so we must all take it as a national issue and come out. In Ghana, we are always reactive. We are never proactive. 5 police personnel being killed. Somebody killed here and there. And we are still waiting for a greater disaster. If we don't take care, what we saw at Ayahuasca was we're gone, will just be a little drop. Anything can happen during the elections. Because in Ghana, it's always like, you get it by all means. And that brings about all this kind of tension. The winner takes it all and blah, blah, blah. So if they can use the gun to intimidate people, to get power, let us see what is going to happen at the various campaigns. And even the election days, we must be proactive and resolve the problem of December 7th or December 8th, whatever the date is, now before it happens.
Now we have a law now,
yes,
that is, you know, is on vigilantism.
Good.
Which His Excellency has signed.
Mm-hmm.
We pray and hope that that will control
mm-hmm.
the use of weapons by the various political, you know, parties. But do you have a word for them? Because normally, even if we don't have vigilante groups, you have said some few seconds ago that in this country we can't control the number of small arms that an individual can acquire.
Yes.
So people can still have them and then give to their call them their boys. Yeah. You know, do you have a word for them?
Yes. Let us put Ghana first. Politicians, you plan to come and develop Ghana to make us live better, not to destroy it. Liberia is not far, and we know what took place there. Sierra Leone is not far. I've been to Sierra Leone several times, and when you go there, you still weep. See what is happening in Burkina Faso, Nigeria. You know the story of Rwanda. So let us stop piling up guns. Let us stop building private armies. Let us stop, you know, arming people for the sake of power and then to destroy the nation that we want to build. There are so many challenges in our country: hunger, poverty, education, health, and whatnot. We need to pull our efforts together to build, not to, for the sake of looking for power, tear this nation apart.
You mentioned earlier on that you are looking for, especially the magazine people, are looking for a vehicle even to go run. Aside government support, where else do you have support for this very crucial, important, because at the moment, what you are telling us, we all want the gun control, we want discipline, gun use, order, but you are telling us that until we have a law, and I mean, we strengthen the law, we are far away from our dreams.
Oh, I wish, as I'm speaking, businesses, banks, corporate bodies, churches, the Christian Council, the Ghana Pentecostal Council, anybody will hear my humble plea and donate at least one vehicle. It could be second hand or third hand. A vehicle that I can give to the Kumasi Blasphemies Association. They really want to work. They really want, because they say that whenever you say on the TV or the radio that we are, you know, producing these guns, they say that we are united. We don't want to do that. But there's no means for us to regulate them. In fact, they want us to help them to establish even one factory to produce, you know, hoes and cutlasses and other things that would be good for agriculture, like what is said in the Bible. They don't want to produce the arms. And also the market is there, because people, you know, it's a demand and supply. People are always finding avenues, even though they have legitimate way of going to buy the proper gun. These guns are very cheap, And so there's always the demand. So these are some of the complications. But we need a vehicle. As I'm standing, I'm speaking here, if anybody will hear me and donate a vehicle to the Kumasi Blacksmiths Association, I'll be more than glad so that they can protect us.
Asafo, do colleague ministers and the people around them in Ghana today carry arms to church and Christian gathering?
I must say I've never seen one myself, but I wouldn't be surprised if it is not done, because there is no law debarring them from carrying arms if they have registered them. And there are no law telling them where they can take guns and where they cannot take guns. But honestly, I haven't seen one yet.
Now, would you advise pastors to carry guns to church?
I will not advise that. If you need protection and you think your place is porous, get to the police or some of the security agents. Nobody is supposed to arm himself for self-protection. You should get the police or some of the security agencies to do that for you. So I will not advise pastors to carry arms or get armed guards. If you see anybody going holding arms to protect himself or getting some people other than the police or the military or the security agents, then the whole people are acting illegally. It's against the law for you to do that.
But at the moment, the Ghana Police Service, they are also under attack. Are you sure they are doing enough that we should go to bed trusting that all will be well, knowing that now they have come under attack, gun attacks?
I want to take this opportunity to express my condolences again to the families of these officers who have lost their lives. I must say that the police are doing their part. They are risking their lives. They are protecting us in our homes and all the places. But it's a matter of strengthening and equipment. And I thank God that the president and the minister recently said that they should be properly empowered to carry on their job. So to me, most of the police people are doing their part. But there are sometimes bad news, very, very few, minute, I mean, in terms of numbers, but sometimes we overlook at the good number of them who are doing a great work to protect our country, and we blow the few, you know, we make it so big, the few who are not doing the right thing. You know, I think recently I read that some police and military people were caught amongst armed robbers. Serving ones and retired ones. But generally, the police are doing well, and they should continue to do this hard and sacrificial work. I'm only pleading, just as the president has promised and the minister has promised, we should equip them, we should give them more protection, we should help them so that they can also help us.
I think this is very important.
I think they are still under-resourced.
And yet, with the little they have, they are doing so much, and we need to salute the Ghana Police Service. It seems to me that's what you are trying to say.
That's what I'm trying to say. You've put it right for me.
Thank you.
Good.
Asafo, you've heard Benny Hinn, who together with others have preached prosperity with Pentecostal theology, that prosperity will come through sowing seed, tithing. Is the gospel in Ghana for sale?
Thank you very much, but let me make a correction. It's not Pentecostal theology. Pentecostals, Presbyterians, Anglicans, Methodists, we have the same theology. The only four things that we emphasize is Christ the Savior, Christ the Baptizer in the Holy Spirit, Christ the Healer, and Christ the Coming King. This prosperity theology is from America, and people have just bought into it. And I think that there's, in a sense, there are few good things about it, but generally, I don't subscribe to this kind of theology. It is too much one way, and it is not balanced, and it rather promotes greediness and all kind of things. I'm glad that Benny Hinn, after all these years, has come to apologize to the people of Ghana. God wants everybody to prosper, whether you are a Muslim or you are a Christian, you are a Buddhist or you are a Hindu. So Muslims are being prospering, Hindus are being prospering. I've said that hard work, vision and passion can make one prosper. And for Christians, God first, putting God in it. So this sowing, I think it rather makes the preachers more prosperous rather than the givers. So I'm not really in line. I'm not a promoter. I am not an advocate of that kind of prosperity. It looks like when you're material Sunday, you are religious or you are more godly, but some people are ungodly and they are prospering. How do we balance the equation? So I'm glad. Pastors, let us use Ben-Hur's example and begin to preach and teach people to live a godly life, prepare them for heaven. You know, all these things are part of the corruptions that we are seeing. By all means, get rich, be prosperous, be number one, this, ride the best car, live in the best house, drive the best car, be in the first class, in a plane. All these things are rather worldly. So I don't think we should promote it so much. I'm glad that he has made these confessions and it should be a lesson to us all. Now that the prosperity is ending, it is this prosperity that led to these prophetic things that people are giving all kind of weird and wonderful prophecies. So I believe one day we will also have a solution to this kind of prophetic messages that are going on, which really disturbed me so much.
Will you pray that a day will come some colleague ministers will go public and make their own confession?
I believe it will come. If somebody like Ben-Hur, who is sitting on multi-million wealth, it's like today he has given away all this technically because he's not going to get them again. It will also happen to in Ghana life one day.
Growing up, what was your experience of churches?
Well,
in terms of wealth, the churches that you witnessed in your youthful day.
Well, I started as a Catholic. Then through scriptures, you know, I became Assemblies of God member. And the churches focused, both in the Catholic Church and Assemblies of God, even after now, was not on wealth. The focus was on God. The focus was on worship. The focus was helping people to live and better their lives on earth and also think about heaven. So for us, it was the normal offerings or the harvest or the thanksgiving and the Kofinian mess that we use and we give, you know, to support the kingdom of God. The emphasis was rather on holiness and holy living and being productive citizens. And to me, what I'm seeing in the religious landscape now is completely different from what I saw in the Catholic Church through the scriptures, you know, and in the Assemblies of God of those days. Because even in these days, some of our pastors are subtly caught up thinking that everything is about wealth and material gains. And I think it's a malaise to the African church, especially the Pentecostals and the Charismatics.
So for where did we go wrong?
Discipleship. The church has failed to educate people to grow. You know, in the Great Commission, we are to make disciples of all nations. Now, everything is prayer, everything is prophetic, everything is anointing. And when we became Christians, I don't want to refer to the scriptures because that's my background, we were called to serve. Our challenge was evangelism, serving, now to receive. So people don't go to church with the idea of going to worship God or serve, but they go to God only to receive the blessings and the prosperities, the double, everything. And the Christianity has become like going to get rather than going to give. To me, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. So if we want to follow the example of God, we should give our very best for the kingdom of God. You know, this is this prosperity preaching, they tell you, give and you shall receive. So people don't even give because they love God or because they don't want the kingdom of God to expand, but because they want to receive back in abundance. I'm not against that, but that should not be our motive. It should be secondly. The first motive of giving is for the advancement of the work of God. Whether we receive back or we don't receive back, that should not be the question.
Reverend Professor from Puma Mansion, you are the chairman of Ghana Pentecostal Charismatic Council. Mm-hmm. You mentioned the Catholic Church and mm-hmm. the Assemblies of God.
Yes.
Now, these are churches, mm-hmm. they are wealth. Mm-hmm. They belong to the institution,
yes.
the Catholic Church,
mm-hmm.
the Assemblies of God, mm-hmm. the Presbyterian Church.
Yes.
And then they will spread it.
Yes.
They will send the money to mm-hmm. education,
yes.
to health.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you are telling me we are having churches mm-hmm. in this country. The church members are building the fortune of the leaders, the founders. The monies are going to the founder because you have giving for his birthday, his wife's birthday, his jubilee anniversary, and he's been into ministry in this number of years, and you are all sowing seed. And at the end of the day, some of them even don't account to anybody. So now churches are rich, but the wealth belong to individual, their estate, their universities, everything belong to individual. Mm-hmm. Is that what you are telling me?
Well, this question is really very difficult, but I'll try. Like, you know, Presbyterian, Assemblies of God, Methodist, Pentecost, we are just like civil servants. We are paid at the end of the month, and that is all. We don't have any claim on anything that comes to the church. Some of the churches have started as individual, but they are growing and they are opening branches. I don't know how they use their money. I will perceive that some of them, well, the leaders receive this thing, but probably they also pass it on to support the ministry because they are the face and the figurehead of the ministry. I want to believe that as they go through successions over time, some of these things may change. But my advice to all religious leaders, both Pentecostals, charismatics, or whatever, the Bible says we brought nothing to this world and we will take nothing out of it. So whenever we get our food and raiment, that should be sufficient for us. We must not use any way to manipulate or extract wealth from our people and live in abundance and leave them in abject poverty. If the Lord blesses us with the money, whether it is through your birthday, your jubilee, your whatever, put the money back into the ministry so that those who are hungry, who are homeless, who are sick, who are in prison, who are suffering, will also benefit from the generous giving of the people's money. I want to say that whenever people go to church, they don't give the money to any pastor because no pastor has died for anybody. It is Jesus who died for us. And because we love him and we are serving him, we are only channels to receive these resources. We should pass it on to support the needy or people in the churches. If we use this money anyhow, one day we will stand before God and we will render accounts. So to every pastor, to every prophet, to every evangelist, we are going to render accounts to God on our stewardship of anything that people give into the church. So we must be careful how we spend God's resources. Let me add that when people give tithes and offerings and it is used for the church work, all the other monies that come, our universities, our hospitals, our clinics, our cars, our businesses, we should also pay tax to the nation. It is godly, it is scriptural that we also render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's, so that Caesar can give us good roads, good schools, and good clinics, and good water, sanitation, and environment. So if you drive in a bumper road and your church is doing business and you're not paying tithe, you are contributing to the poor roads in the country.
What is next? You mentioned Scripture Union
mm-hmm.
for your youthful school
yes.
days.
Yes.
That is the kind of spirituality that produces you and many more.
Yes.
You know. Now, what kind of spirituality do you think Ghanaian young people, our students, need that will give them that quality, spiritual quality, that balance into the future?
Yeah, I think the church has become so much of entertainment these days than discipline. I want to tell you, the daily power and the daily guide that we used to read every morning. You know, as you, it's your daily power, your daily guide. You read it and the Bible speaks to you, and there are lists of prayers they have left, they're listed. Scripture to memorize, pray for someone, is anything good for me? This is help us. So we, the churches, should tackle the problem from our children's church and from our people in the JSS and in the secondary school. I don't know whether else is doing that. During our time, they were very, very, very strong in the secondary schools, especially people from KNUSD and the rest. They visit us every weekend, school camps and rallies. If the SU is not doing that, and they've done their part, I think they are doing it. If not, the churches should step in. The churches are more interested in people when they have grown and they are working and they can pay tithe or they can sow seed and they can do A, B, C, and D. But we must train up the child the way he should go, so that when he grows, he will not depart from it. This leads me to another question. With the religious and moral education, I went to a Christian school. Every Sunday, you have to go to church, and somebody will write your name. And on Sunday, they will check, they will make records. Those who went to Presby, those who went to Catholic, those who went to Methodist, and the rest. Now, government has taken all these schools, Presby. See the number of schools you have. Methodist, Anglican, and we even the Pentecostals have got some. And there's no monitoring the faith element. And I heard that even they want to remove the religion and morals from school, but thank God they couldn't, because Catholic and the Presby and the GPCC, both Christian Council and Catholic Bishops Conference and GPCC, we made a strong case and we couldn't remove them. So the church, you know, coming out of the school, making our school so much secular, has become the issue. We must, if not giving them back to us as we have been advocating, we should have greater influence in putting people of character, people of Christian faith, people who believe in God, to be head teachers and directors. That will change. I remember those days, the education officer called DO or DE or something like that. When they come, they everything was sound. I mean, the education was sound. And you can build character and morality. But now, everything is in jeopardy. It's a serious. You are a teacher, so you know more than I do. We need to revisit our education, how it has fallen down from A to Z. It is not enough to get grades to go to Achimota or go to Legon. Character should be the greatest premium of one's education.
What is next? And I'm in conversation with Reverend Professor Frimpong Manso. He is the president of the Assemblies of God Church and the chairman, National Commission on Small Arms and Light Weapons, and also the chairman of Ghana Pentecostal Charismatic Council. So for, you are one of the very enviable pastors in this country. You head a church, that in that church, you have a member, even when he was a sitting president, he was still a member, active one.
Yes.
A president, a former president of this country, and chief justice. At the time, they were all in the church that you have served as the head. What do you do in that church that the president of this country, chief justice of this country, in fact, even now, the majority leader and others are still members in your church? What do you do in that church that people can carry from Sunday into Monday as they go into public service?
It's preaching the gospel. Assemblies of God, we normally have an acolyte, AG, or the gospel. We preach the gospel and we tell people to translate what they hear in church on Sundays to their practical lives during the week. So our emphasis, our strength is only the gospel.
Yes, only the gospel. Mm-hmm. But when the president moves into his office as a president of this country, he's not a preacher.
Mm-hmm.
When the chief justice moves into office, she's not a preacher.
Mm-hmm.
When the majority leader moves to parliament, they are into a different world.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of public policy, in terms of good governance, mm-hmm. in terms of the things that we need for sustainable development,
mm-hmm.
can you tell my viewers
mm-hmm.
programs in your church that deliberately is shaping people to connect church and public service?
Well, the Bible says we are the salt and, of course, the light. So, basically, it is normal teachings, Sunday school. We have departments for men, women, children, and all these things. These are generally the things that we do, and, of course, sometimes symposium, special talks from people like you. You know, we believe that Christianity should not be theoretical or herd knowledge. So we encourage them to follow the example of Daniel during his, you know, service in Babylon, to follow the example of Joseph in Egypt. And so we tell them that Christianity is not how much you behave on church on Sundays, you sing the hymns, you pray in tongues, or you prophesy, or you use religious or Christian languages, but how you behave at a workplace. But then, no pastor is there to monitor whatever. So we believe that at their workplaces, they make a difference.
Asafo, some church members, in fact, your church members
mm-hmm.
expect people like you
mm-hmm.
to speak truth to
mm-hmm.
power.
Mm-hmm.
To those mm-hmm. in power, for their sake.
Mm-hmm.
Have you done that before?
Always. And we are still doing that. We use the pulpit to do that.
Your last word for my viewers.
My last word is that we've talked about the Guam situation. And all of us will be our brother's keeper. We must support the security agencies. And also pray that our laws will quickly be changed so that the Small Arms Commission can work. We talk about this prosperity thing. If you want to prosper, work hard. Of course, trust in God. But don't just go and give and give and give and give. Or I didn't even mention that. 1 week all night, praying during the working hours, spending your time at mountains to pray for manna to draw. That is laziness. So we must work. We must also believe God. We must also be faithful. In terms of church, especially when we have people like presidents and former presidents in the church, we should preach the truth to them and we should not compromise. And we should encourage them also to allow their lives to be shined wherever they are. Because my concern has been, why 70% Christians we claim to be, and there's still so much corruption, corruption, corruption. To me, it doesn't tell you, it doesn't work out. 70%. And we see what we're seeing. So we all, pastors, members, and everybody, we should do well to change the situation we are in Ghana.
Thank you very much. This is What Is Next, a program that will be coming to you every Thursday, 4 to 5, seeking relevant answers for some contemporary challenges that we must address for our own good. The hallmark of this program is our common good. This is our nation. We must build it together. The common good must drive us into the future. We will expect you next week, Thursday, same time, to tune in to What Is Next as we go through the future together. Again, my guest has been the Reverend Professor Frimpong Mansour. It's been wonderful.
Thank you.
This is GTV, the authentic and the trusted voice of Ghana. Thank you very much. See you next week. Asafo, thanks for being our maiden guest.
Thank you.
Grateful.
And God bless you.
Thank you.
Thank you.